open mind, free to examine, to question, to disagree. Our subject today, the new Negro. Your host on The Open Mind is Richard D. Heffner, author and historian.
I think it's safe to say that the lot of the Negro in America has, throughout our history, deeply bothered the conscience of each and every one of us who deeply believes in traditional American principles of democracy and liberty and justice and freedom. I think this may be a little less true today than ever before, and yet for the larger part of American history, I think we ought to realize that the Negro, more or less, was in slavery. I think the Negro was more likely to be a slave for the greater part of our history than not. And quite naturally, the attitude of the Negro towards the white, of the white towards the Negro, and of the Negro towards himself, has been conditioned and tempered and molded in very large part by the fact of a long history of slavery. Besides, I think it's important to remember that slavery as an institution put a premium not upon self-assertiveness and the understanding of one's own human dignity, but upon acquiescence by the Negro's slave. And I think that one can fairly say that the acquiescent, submissive Negro slave was generally, well, to put it very bluntly, generally safer than the self-assertive Negro who is conscious of his own human dignity and of the democratic philosophy that is the American heritage. As a matter of fact, I think we can admit that the whole myth that we have built up about the Old South, in which slavery existed, has been a myth in which we see the picture of the happy, acquiescent slave. The Negro is a slave. The Negro who is acquiescent is happy. The Negro who is happy is, by definition, acquiescent. Negroes are happy because they accept their lot. And think of the movies and the books and the plays and the novels that we read and see about slavery in the Old South. We see the Negro who is acquiescent as happy. The Negro slave who is self-assertive, who looks for his own rights, is considered a troublemaker. Even when slavery was brought to an end by the Civil War, it was said that acquiescence and acceptance by the Negro of his lot, well, these were the greater part of wisdom. It was said that the Negro could gain more by submerging his own sense of dignity than by asserting it. That the Negro would so antagonize others by demanding his own rights that it was better for him to bide his time at each step along the way, wait for something to be given to him rather than demand it as of his own right. Well, men of goodwill, I think both Negro and white cannot deny that to some extent there is validity to this argument. But the degree of that extent, to what extent this is true, is the question that we must face today. In recent years, there have grown up leaders amongst both Negroes and whites who feel that a just and a wise self-assertiveness is necessary on the part of the Negro. There has been emerging in our own times a new Negro, a Negro who is aware of his own dignity and of the American tradition of liberty and justice. We want to talk today about that new Negro, about who he is and what he is, and our guests are quite expert in the subject. My first guest is the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. of Montgomery, Alabama. Reverend King has been very much involved in the demand by the new Negro for his rights in the Negro bus boycott in Montgomery, and in many other instances. My second guest is a jurist, Judge J. Wades Waring, formerly federal judge in South Carolina, a gentleman whose decisions in the area of segregation paved the way in a very real sense for what became in 1954 the Supreme Court's decision that segregation in our public schools is unconstitutional. Well, gentlemen, suppose we begin this discussion by letting me first ask you, Dr. King, in your estimation, what and who is this new Negro?
I think I could best answer that question by saying first that the new Negro is a person with a new sense of dignity and destiny, with a new self-respect. Along with that, Is this like a fear which once characterized the Negro, this willingness to stand up courageously for what he feels is just and what he feels he deserves on the basis of the laws of the land. I think also included would be this self-assertive attitude that you just mentioned. And all of these factors come together to make what seems to me to be the new Negro. I think also I would like to mention this growing honesty which characterizes the Negro today. There was a time that the Negro used duplicity or deception to rather as a survival technique. Although he didn't particularly like conditions, he said he liked them because he felt that the boss wanted to hear that. But now from the housetops, from the kitchen, from the classrooms, and from the pulpits, the Negro says in no uncertain terms that he doesn't like the way he's being treated. So at long last, the Negro is telling the truth. And I think this is also one of the basic characteristics of the new Negro.
Judge Waring, does this sound like an adequate description of the Negro whom you know today?
Honest Hefner, I think it's excellent. It's an excellent summary. My observation of the Negro, and I'm speaking in generalities, of course, has been that up to recently he's been a half-man or a part-man. And now at last he's waking up to the fact that he's a whole man, that he's an American citizen, and that he is entitled to rights, no more, no less, than just the ordinary run-of-the-mill American citizen. He's never had that before. He hasn't been allowed to have it. He's been under political domination. He's been under stress. He's been under economic deprivations. He's been a servant, formerly a slave. And now suddenly I see the idea has come to him that he's really, truly a man that can stand up on his own hind legs and tell the truth and say, I want not any special privilege. I don't want any special handout. I don't want to be given anything because the giving idea is all wrong. But I want a chance to become a full man and do my part, be it little or be it big, in the community of our country.
But doesn't this raise the question of tactics, though? You say, you use the word honesty. You feel that honesty is important here, too. But as a matter of securing for the Negro his rights, do you feel that this aggressiveness, this self-assertiveness, will get him more in the long run than going along with contemporary opinion and biding his time, taking step by step as he goes?
I think it's better to be aggressive at this point. It seems to me that it is both historically and sociologically true that privileged classes do not give up their privileges voluntarily, and they do not give them up without strong resistance. And all of the gains that have been made, that we have received in the area of civil rights, have come about because the Negro stood up courageously for these rights, and he was willing to aggressively press on. So I would think that it would be much better in the long run to stand up and be aggressive with understanding goodwill and with a sense of discipline, yet these things should not be substitutes for pressing on. And with this aggressive attitude, I believe that we will bring the gains or other civil rights into being much sooner than we would just standing idly by, waiting for these things to be given voluntarily.
Well, what about the ill will that's generated by the aggressiveness? Certainly your own experience in Montgomery. You've been the target of bomb attacks. You've been the target of verbal and other kinds of violence. What about the ill will that is generated by aggressiveness?
Well, I think that is a necessary phase of the trend.